recording of the service today. I think it's important that we talk about the coronavirus a little bit. You know, I don't know how many of you spend too much time watching Facebook and stuff, but I saw the coronavirus, COVID, you know, that's the COVID-19 virus, right? And so someone had changed the abbreviation for what it means to, it says, Christ over viruses and infectious diseases, right? I like that, you know? I think that's awesome. Christ over viruses and infectious diseases. They had a little quote there, which comes out of Joshua in chapter 1 and verse 9, and I will read it for you. I think it's fitting because it's COVID-19, and we're looking at Joshua 1, 9. And in Joshua 1, 9, it says, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened, and do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." Amen, right? Hey, now when I look at that, you know, COVID virus 19 kind of thing, man, I am encouraged, right? Because I know Christ is over viruses and infectious diseases. And, you know, I say that, and, you know, I am also concerned for vulnerable people in our population. I'm not saying go out and be stupid, right? Like if you're compromised or whatever, or have a weakened immune system, whatever it happens to be, man, stay at home, you know? Absolutely stay at home. If you have it, please stay at home. This, I feel that this is the start of something new, you know? This is a different kind of a change. And I'm just waiting to see what God is going to do with it, you know? I mean, how long has it been since the President of the United States has declared a National Day of Prayer? Amen. You know what I'm saying? Like, something is changing here, you know what I'm saying? And I love it, right? A National Day of Prayer. The Southern Baptist have also declared this a day of praying over the national pandemic. We have a national state of emergency going on. There's a lot of stuff that's happened this last week. You know, I think Nehemiah. Right? Are you guys familiar with the story of Nehemiah? A little bit? All right. Let's see if we can get a little more familiar with Nehemiah. This is not the sermon. This is just the lead up to the sermon. So hold on. All right. So Nehemiah, once again, in the beginning of the book of Nehemiah, Nehemiah tells the account of Nehemiah, who was taken into captivity and is the king's cupbearer, right? So he was taken out of Jerusalem. Jerusalem was destroyed. The city was destroyed. The walls were taken down. The people were taken into captivity. Not really a great place to be, you know, in exile. And in Nehemiah 1:3, it says, "The remnant there in the province." Now, this is a witness that came from Jerusalem and was talking to Nehemiah about what was going on in Jerusalem. He says, "The remnant there in the province who had survived exile was in great trouble and shame. The walls of Jerusalem were broken down. Its gates were destroyed by fire." Right? You know what? We're the remnant of the church, right? Right here in the building. We are also a remnant, right? Here in this very building, we are the remnant of the church who has survived, right? You see a lot of people turning away from Christ nowadays, you know. You see the younger generation, they go to college and they move away, they lose their faith. We are the remnant of the church. In this way, we're in the same condition as those people in Jerusalem, right? We have survived. But indeed, we are in great trouble and shame, just as the people in Jerusalem were, right? There's this pandemic going on, national state of emergency, all this kind of stuff that's going on. It says that your walls do not protect you. The gates are destroyed, right? There's no walls anymore, right? This thing is just sort of going everywhere. And it's as if the very fire of hell has destroyed the gates, right, in our community. And so, you know, it's interesting that Nehemiah, when he gets this report, he isn't like, you know, he doesn't go down to Walmart and buy up every last roll of toilet paper. I don't know, right? I mean, he doesn't, you know, he isn't in shock. He isn't in fear. He isn't worried about this stuff. What does it say that he does in verse 4? It says he sat, he wept, he mourned, he fasted, he prayed, right? I think those are great alternatives, right? To getting all like freaked out about this thing, right? I think if we sat and we wept and we mourned and we prayed and we fasted about this thing, we'd be a lot more productive than just wringing our hands. It continues on in Nehemiah verses 17 and 18. I'll read that for you. It says here, and then, so he gathered the people of Jerusalem together and he said to them, you see the trouble we are in now. Jerusalem lies in ruins. Its gates have been burned. Come, let us build the wall of Jerusalem that we may no longer suffer derision. And I told them of the hand of my God that had been placed upon me for good, and also the works that the king had spoken to me about. And they said, let us rise up and build. Right? Let us rise up and build, right? Let's be constructive during this time. Let's provide for the common defense, right? Let's, you know, I heard this thing once before, you know, if you're working, if you're active, it's a whole lot more difficult to do hand-wringing, right? Right? If you're serving other people, it's hard to wring your hands constantly, right, about what's going on. You know, let us have some backbone. That's what Nehemiah was saying. Let us have some backbone. Let us do something about our situation. We want to no longer suffer derision. You know what derision means? I had to look it up. I was like, that's a Bible word. I don't know. So derision means ridicule, mockery, reproach, disgrace. You know, I don't know about you guys, but sometimes people make fun of my faith. You know, they mock. Hey, you go to church every Sunday. You know, they say, hey, you know, what are you doing that for? We're going to Snowmobile Church. You should go to Snowmobile Church too. You know, we're going to do 200 miles today. What's that? Sometimes they call the cops on me for preaching in my church. I'm like, what is going on? Right? So there's some crazy stuff that goes on, right? There's some crazy stuff. You know, let's show people what Christians are like, right? How Christians act and how Christians respond in love, right? Let's rise up. Let's build. Let's act together. Let's strengthen our hands, right? It says they strengthened their hands for the work ahead, right? Let's strengthen our hands for the good work. Get prepared, right, to invite God's strength, right? We want to operate in God's strength, right, in order to do this. So there's a lot, you know, of stuff that's going on, and I wanted to talk to you a little bit about church, right, and how we're going to sort of help protect people, right? So here's the deal. We're going to have greeters at the front door, and they're going to open the door for you. You don't have to touch that nasty handle. They'll open the door for you, and there'll be hand sanitizer right there for you to use so that you can clean up and we make sure that everybody's clean, right? There's a bottle right here next to the elevator, and as people come up from downstairs, there's another opportunity. If you don't like to use hand sanitizer or can't, there's a bathroom. We got plenty of soap. Please don't take the toilet paper. No. You're going to be good, right? It's all going to be good. Also, Julie has been doing a fantastic job in sanitizing all the surfaces, right? So she spends a lot of her day, thank you, Julie, just cleaning up and making sure that it's clean in here and it's a good place for us to come and to worship. And, you know, that's a wonderful, wonderful thing. Okay, so we're doing what we can to reduce the hazards, right? And once again, don't feel you have to come out of, you know, some sort of commitment. If you're not feeling well, if you have somebody at home that isn't, you know, doing well, I totally understand you guys not coming. Our app is in the process. It seems like it's taken longer to get approved. I don't know, because maybe of the stuff that's going on. Our hope is we can start to publish on the app our videos. But in the meantime, we do have a YouTube channel. I am going to record today and, you know, give me some time, but tonight, tomorrow morning, something like that, I'll have a video up on YouTube and I'll put out the link on Facebook, and folks can go there and take a look at it. And so we want to make sure that you still have the opportunity to worship and don't miss out on our time together. Okay, so what are we doing to help build the walls of Jerusalem, right? What are we doing? So we have been contacted by the City of Barrie emergency management people. You know, what a privilege, right? Right? It's sort of like the king. The king, right? The local government has come and said, hey, we need you to lead an effort in Barrie for feeding those people who may need food and stuff, right? And so we have been working on fixing up again, cleaning up our old soup kitchen location right down on Summer Street. And our plan is to have that facility up. The volunteers are going to go inside, wash their hands, cook food there or bring food there, whatever. And then for those folks that were there, you remember the little ice cream window? We're going to serve food on disposable plates outside that window so people don't have to come into the building. And we're working on getting a tent set up over by the Presbyterian Church so that they can go over there and eat. You know, praise God. You know, here is a solution. Here is a way that the church, right, can stand up and do something in our community, right, that others are like, I don't know how that's going to happen. I don't know how, you know, we're going to take care of these people who need to be taken care of. And so we have actually had a number of the other churches in Barrie stand up and say, hey, we're going to help out with that. We'll do breakfast. We'll do lunches, dinners, whatever happens to be. We're still going to do our Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Sunday meals over there. I think the plan is we're going to keep some food here for the congregation to have, but our public point of distributing food will be over at the old church building. And so a coalition of Christians are getting together to be the hands and feet of the God, right? Hands and feet of God. That's what it's all about, right? Okay. In case you forgot. Okay. You know, when others run and hide and cower, they will also see Christians gathering together to pray and help others out, you know? We're not hoarding for ourselves, but we are caring and showing love for others in our community. God's love, amen. Right? You know, some, you know, I've seen this, you know, posted from time to time. It says, some run from explosions in fear and trembling, but Christians run toward it in faith, hope, and love, amen. Right? We want to be the ones that are running to the needs of of our community and working that out. You know, and I really do believe this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity.
That's right.
You know? When was the last time we had like a national emergency? You know, I think we can go all the way back probably to World War II. You know, it's been that long since we've had a national, you know, emergency. And, you know, this is a unique opportunity in our lifetime to show Christ's love for our community, right? And it may just be the feeding of people with food that need it, you know, in our community. But, you know, it's important that we show that the church is where we get our hope, right? Why we do not fear in the storm. How we rely on the strength of the Savior who still lives.
Amen.
And who our faith lies. Right? So I just wanted to say that today. I mean, I'm like, let's lean into this thing, you know. Let's not be afraid. Let's not be fearful. You know, I think there are lots of opportunities. We have some people already within the congregation. Probably 6 or 8 people that normally come to church with us that are in isolation because they have compromised immune systems. I think we ought to be calling those people. I think we ought to be delivering meals to them. I think we ought to be checking in on them, making sure that they're okay. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Yeah. I was hoping you were going to say that because I was going to drive the wheels off my truck, but that's okay, you know. Like, I think this is a really good thing, and we need to come together to take care of our Christian brothers and sisters, but also to reach out to our community. And so, the next thing that I want to do is, I'm not going to do an individual prayer time today because we're sort of into it already. We got a baptism today. We got a lot of stuff going on. So I'm going to press forward on here, but I do want to, and this hasn't been working for me today either. I don't know how that works, but you know, the laser still works. I can still drive the dog crazy, but you know, won't change slides. So I'll just have to reach over here and change slides for us today. But for prayer and praise, let's all bow our heads. Let's be in prayer about the things that are going on in our nation and in our community. Lord God, we love you, Lord. We love you so much, Lord. Lord, we know that you are a caring and gracious and wonderful Father, Lord. Lord, we know that you have a wonderful plan in store. Lord, I don't know how this is all going to work out, Lord. I don't know if this is but the start of a new revival, Lord. But I pray that you'd use this time of this pandemic, Lord, to emphasize with people the importance of being in right relationship with you. Lord, we love you. Lord, we love the things that you're doing. Lord, I call out a blessing today upon all the members of our community, Lord, that may be vulnerable to this disease, Lord, and we just ask that you would be with them, that you would draw them close, Lord, that in their fear and in their trembling, Lord, they would turn their eyes to you. Lord, that they would see you as their heavenly Father, their great protector, Lord. Lord, I know there's a lot of prayer going on, Lord, and we just ask for that to continue, Lord, that you would continue to soften their hearts and turn them to you. Lord, we pray this all in Jesus' precious name. Amen. All right, and you know what else? Yes.
I just wondered, Dan, if you were looking for volunteers, I don't know if you were or not.
Yeah.
I don't know if the word is or not. I just checked.
Okay. I thought you were volunteering.
I am.
You know what I'm saying? I don't know. It to me, it's sort of like in the military, right? Like they say, hey, would all the volunteers step forward?
Oh,
you know, and sort of everybody stands up, right? But nobody comes forward. One guy just steps back, and it's like, ooh, all you guys just volunteered, right? I am trusting in the Lord that among the congregation, if I need something and I call on somebody and I say, hey, can you help me out? If you can, you will. Yeah. Right? Amen. I don't think I need to get a list together of people who are going to say, amen, I am going to help take care of my brothers and sisters, right? I think if I call, you're going to be like, amen, I'll do that. I'll do what I can, right? And that's all I ask, right? In the same case with Nehemiah, you know, he asked that every household rebuild the wall in front of their house, right? And that's what I'm looking for, right? You can't do everything, but man, if I call on you and I'm saying, hey, we got this deep need, can you help out? Amen, I'm going to put the bricks in the wall in front of my house, right? I am going to build that thing up. So, I think in answer to the question, yeah, you in the military, we call that voluntold, right? You've all been voluntold that, you know, we're gonna help out to the extent that you can, right? No, I don't want to put anybody in any danger, but we're all going to step forward on this thing.
Chose me has always been a mystery. All my life I've been told I belong at the end of the line with all the other not quite, with all the never get it right. But it turns out they're the ones you were looking for all this time, 'cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Moses had stage fright, and David brought a rock to a sword fight. You picked 12 outsiders nobody would have chosen, and you changed the world. Well, the moral of the story is everybody's got a purpose. So when I hear that devil start talking to me, saying, who do you think you are? I say, I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. So let me go down, down, down in history as another blood-bought, faithful member of the family. And if they all forget my name, well, that's fine with me. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. So let me go down, down, down in history. Go down in history. Has another blood-bought, faithful member of the family. That's all I ever wanna be. And if they all forget my name, well, that's fine with me. For the world to see, nobody but Jesus. 'Cause I'm just a nobody, trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
To Christ. And so this is a super exciting time. Anybody who wants to take pictures or video or whatever, you're welcome to come down front. So Cheyenne, have you professed faith in your Lord Jesus?
loving obedience from here on out.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Well, then in that case, I am prepared to baptize you. Let's turn this way a little bit. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Face to face.
darkness, my God, that is who you are. Every heart, I worship you.
His name is above. His name is above depression. His name is above loneliness. Oh, His name is above disease. His name is above cancer. His name is above every other name. That is who
is an occurrence that each man deems unnatural when related to himself, but natural when related to others. We know the other man's going to die. We know that cancer is going to hit the other person. We know that that other person may die of a heart attack or be in an automobile crash tomorrow, but not me. And we live as though we're going to live like this forever, and we're not. It'll all be over in a short time for everybody here. And you'll be in eternity. Where will you be? The word hell today is constantly used as a swear word. You hear it on television, you see it in the films, you see it in the writings of people, and you hear it at work, and you hear it in school. Now, this is an unpopular and controversial and misunderstood subject. You can never understand hell, though, until first you understand the great love, mercy, and grace of God. And it should never be preached by any preacher without tears. I've heard some preachers preach on hell as though they were glad there was a hell and glad that people were going there. But I'm not. I don't like to preach on it. I do it only because I'm commanded in Scripture to preach the Word. And it's against the backdrop of God's love and mercy and grace that I must preach it. The Bible teaches that there are at least three kinds of hell. First, there is hell in the heart. Thousands of people here tonight have hell in your heart. And that's where it all begins. Much of the world assumes that human nature is good, but the Bible teaches that it's basically evil. By nature, we are selfish, sinful, wayward, and lost. In sin did my mother conceive me, said David. We're all sinners, and we were born in sin. And then when we reach the age of accountability, we chose to sin. Then we became sinners by practice. There's the hell of guilt. A man who wrote me some time ago who was cheating on his wife. He was living part-time with another woman in another city. And he said, I'm actually living in hell. He found himself caught. And it was hell. Secondly, the Bible teaches that there's hell around us. Isaiah 14:9 has a very descriptive verse and a very mysterious verse and a very interesting verse when you study it. Hell from beneath is moved for thee to meet thee at thy coming. Hell from beneath is moved. Read it in the Living Bible, the 14th chapter of Isaiah, the whole thing. And it's an interesting passage to read. There's hell in the home. Hell in society. When a situation becomes intolerable, many people say, all hell is broken loose. And a secular, godless world revels in its lusts. It rejects the gospel and takes lust. And others are living in a hell of greed. The Bible teaches that as we approach the end of the age, that people more and more will be taken up with greed to get what we can get now, live for the now. And they want instant satisfaction, just like instant tea or all the instant things we see advertised on television. We want instant gratification. We want it now. Hell has been moved to earth. And then thirdly, and lastly, there's the hell in the future. And the future hell is a projection of the hell that you have now in your heart, in your home, in our world, except it goes on and on. Jesus spoke more about hell than any person in the Bible, but he warned us to flee from it. It is the very fact of hell that makes the love of God so amazing and so glorious. The fact that it was made for the devil and his angels, and we listen to the devil and follow the devil and we do what the devil says. And yet God loves us so much that he devised a plan to save us so that we'll never have to spend one day in hell. His grace and his mercy is so thrilling. But for the love of God and the sacrifice of Christ on the cross, every one of us would end up in hell. And hell, but hell need not be your final destination. You need not live in it up on this earth. It can be taken from your heart. It can be removed from your home, all by the grace of God. And I could tell you story after story of men and women who've come to Christ and the hell has been removed from their hearts and their lives. Now, what is the nature of hell? Well, many mysteries surrounding this subject. Essentially and basically, it is separation from God. We are separated from God by sin, and that continues out into eternity. And there are three words that Jesus used to describe hell. He used the word death. You see, God is life, and you're separated from the life of God. You're dead. Spiritually dead, separated from God. And then he used the word outer darkness. God is light. We're separated from the light, so we live in darkness. And then he uses the word fire. And I've often wondered if that is a terrible fire within our hearts for God, for fellowship with God that can never be quenched. And the scripture says, prepare to meet thy God. You know, we prepare for everything except death. We prepare for education, business, careers, marriage, old age, but not for the moment of judgment. We take out every kind of insurance that we possibly can, and we worry about our old age pensions and social security and all the rest of it. But do you have assurance of your relationship with Christ? It's appointed unto men once to die, but after that, the judgment. And you feel that you don't have a spiritual need. What about that person that says that they're happy and got a good income, a good job, a good family, and all the rest? I don't need God. I don't need Christ. What do I need him for? You're going to need him, brother and sister. You're going to need him very badly before very long. You better come now while you have an opportunity. The Bible says now is the accepted day, time. Now is the day of salvation. Come when you can. You can't come to Christ just any time you want to. You can come only when the Holy Spirit has convicted you and drawn you, and where the Word of God has been proclaimed. Have you come to Christ? As I said in the beginning, I don't like to speak on this subject, but it's a part of the Bible, and it's an important part of the teachings of Jesus Christ. And I'm not saying these things myself. I'm only passing on to you the teaching of Christ, what Jesus taught. And I do it with a broken heart. I wish there were no such thing as hell, but there is. I wish there were no such thing as sin, but there is. I wish there were no such thing as murders and wars and all that, but there is. And there is a hell, but thank God there's a heaven. There's a paradise.
Today is Luke 16, verses 19 through 31. You know, if you will notice in your Bibles, if you have a red letter Bible, you look at this. This section is a quote from Jesus, right? This is a direct quote from Jesus, right? Jesus, we know, before he came to earth, was where? In heaven with his Father, right? And so my guess is he is telling us in this section about what he has seen, what he has personally observed going on between heaven and hell. And so Jesus is going to tell us about this. He says, there was a rich man who would dress in purple and fine linens, feasting lavishly every day. But a poor man named Lazarus was covered with sores and lying at the gate. He longed to be filled with what fell from the rich man's table, but instead the dogs came and licked his sores. One day the poor man died and was carried away by angels to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. And being in the torment of Hades, he looked up and he saw Abraham a long distance off and with Lazarus at his side. Father Abraham, he called out, have mercy on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, because I am in agony in this flame. Son, Abraham said, remember that during your life you received your good things, just as Lazarus received bad things. But now he is comforted here, while you are in agony. Besides all this, a great chasm has been fixed between you, so that those who want to pass over from here to you cannot, and neither can those from there cross over to us. Father, he said, then I beg you, please send him to my father's house, because I have five brothers. Warn them so that they won't also come to this place of torment. But Abraham said, they have Moses and the prophets. They should listen to them. No, Father Abraham, he said, but if someone from the dead goes to them, they will repent. But he told them, if they don't listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be persuaded if someone rises from the dead. Whoa. Yeah. Whoa. Is that pretty heavy? You know, I'm thinking about Jesus right now, and he knows where he's going. He knows the whole, you know, crucifixion on the cross. Jesus knew that in that moment that he was crucified, that it, as it says right here, people will not be persuaded because someone rises from the dead. Is that not true today? Yeah. There's a lot of people who still don't believe. And Jesus rose from the dead. And he told them about heaven and hell. They didn't listen. Right? Well, I guess Jesus wasn't surprised. Hey, let's take a historical look at this. Look, I don't know how many of you might feel a bit inspired to witness to the lost, but here it is. It doesn't matter how uncomfortable a conversation is at the dinner table, or work, or anywhere else. Hell is much more uncomfortable a spot for a much longer period of time. Right? Amen?
Yes.
Yeah. So like in a Southern Baptist church, when they like say, yeah, right? Like that. Yeah, everybody's supposed to say, amen, right?
Yay.
Okay, we're gonna a little audience participation. Okay? All right. The Bible records the account of the rich man and the poor man who both die. The poor man goes to heaven and is embraced by Abraham. The rich man dies and he suffers in hell. Looks across the great divide into heaven and asks for mercy, water, and someone to warn his family to avoid this place of torment. God does not send anyone to hell. We go of our own volition as we rejected Christ. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him.
Amen.
Right? Amen. Right? That's John 3:16. Right? That's the deal. Joseph Baxter, he was a Puritan pastor, and he had this to say on his perspective of both heaven and hell. He directed his church members on how to spend a day with God. Let God have your first waking thoughts. Lift up your hearts to him reverently and thankfully for the rest you enjoyed the night before, and cast yourself upon him for the day which follows. Familiarize yourself so consistently with what your consequence may be that it would check your thoughts from falling outside. Think of the mercy of a night's rest and how many spent that night in hell. How many spent that night in prison? How many spent that night in cold? How many spent that night in hard lodgings? How many suffered from agonizing pains and sickness, weary in their beds and of their lives? Think of how many souls that were that night called from their bodies terrifyingly to appear before God. Think about how quickly the days and nights are rolling on. How speedily our last night, our last day will come. Observe which is lacking in your preparedness of your soul for such a time, and seek it without delay. That's pretty powerful, right? Pretty powerful. Hey, I've got a little bit of something different today. I wish my clicker would work, but it's not, so I'm going to have to go over here. Is everybody familiar with the game of Family Feud?
Yes.
Yes? All right. So you know in Family Feud when they like reveal the new, you know, most popular kind of thing, everybody, what do they do? What do they do? David doesn't know, he doesn't watch TV. Right? They all repeat what it says, right? Right? Well, whatever the thing is, they repeat that thing. And so we're gonna do that today. And so this first Family Feud Hell Edition is Hell is a place. Hell is a place, right? And so the number one answer for hell is a place is hell is a place for eternity. Hell is a place for eternity, right? I remember when reading this scripture the first time, and I first understood that Christ wasn't the only way to eternity, right? You know, lots of us say, hey, you know, through Christ you can have eternal life. Well, you know what? If you don't have faith in Christ, you're still getting an eternal life. Amen. It's just at a different location, you know? So if you want your choice of either smoking or non-smoking, right, you make your choice up early, right? Right? So if you want the smoking section, you just reject Christ, right? You're in hell forever, right? If you want the non-smoking version, where do you choose?
Heaven.
You choose heaven through Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Okay, so the first of heaven, or hell, is for eternity. Number two, you ready with me? Hell is a place of pain. Hell is a place of pain, right? In verse 32, we see the rich man is in Hades, being in torment, right? You know, I think about it, you know, the Geneva Convention outlaws torture. Well, apparently the Geneva Convention does not extend beyond the gates of hell, right? Because all manner of torment, all manner of torture is okay there, right? All manner of pain is okay there. We see in Revelation 21 verse 4, it speaks out about heaven, and this is God speaking. He says, he will wipe away every tear from your eyes. Amen. Death shall be no more. Neither shall be there mourning or crying or pain anymore, for the former things have all passed away. You know, I can only come to the understanding that he's telling us that because all those things exist in hell, right? All those things exist. There is mourning. There is crying. There is pain. There is suffering. And nothing is passing away. All right, we're ready for number three. You ready? Hell is a place of fear. Hell is a place of fear, right? In verse 27, we see that the rich man, again, right, he's talking, he says, "Then I beg you, Father, send him to my father's house." The rich man, in his fear of what is going to happen to the rest of his family, they have to suffer the same fate as he does in hell. You know, Proverbs 1:33 says, "But whomever listens to me will dwell securely and will be at ease and without dread of disaster. In heaven we dwell in safety and in ease and without fear." And that's not the experience of the rich man, right? Okay, here's the next point, number four. You ready for it? Hell is a place of sadness. Hell is a place of sadness. Does the rich man sound very happy in this scripture?
No.
No. He is sad for his present condition. He is sad about what will become of his family. He is sad that that condition will never change. You know, in Dante's Divine Comedy, it describes a fictional journey of the author going through hell, ultimately ending up in heaven, which we know biblically can't happen, but he wrote the story anyway. That's why I tell you it's fictional. In the section of Inferno, he describes a sign above the portal to hell, and it says, "Abandon hope, all who enter here." Whew. That's sadness. That's sadness. All right, you ready for number five? Hell is a place of isolation. Hell is a place of isolation. It says that there is a great chasm in verse 26. It separates us eternally from God, who is love. Can you imagine being separated for the rest of your life from love? From God? Wow. Forever isolation alone. God is the God of relationships. And then in hell, the opposite of that would be isolation. No relationships. Maybe the saying is true for the unbeliever. I think you've heard this before. It says, "Alone I entered this world, and alone I shall leave it." Well, maybe that is true for the unbeliever, right? Alone I entered this world, and as I leave it, I'll also be alone. This is written by James Anthony Perdue, a one-time aspiring pastor who then became an atheist. Maybe he should have continued to say, and forward afterwards, "I shall remain alone." Okay, here's our last piece of hell. Hell is a place of separation, right? Of separation, right? There is the great chasm that is referred to in this section. It's not just separation from God, if that isn't bad enough. You see, the rich man is separated from the poor man. There's no more time for apologies. No more time for second chances. No more time for do-overs. Right? It's over with. He is separated from his loved ones. He has no time to help them correct their path or even spend more time with them. He is separated only the living water of Christ, but the physical water. He has no access to the living water of Christ or physical water to simply wither away for all time. You know what, though? You know, as I was preparing this scripture, I said, you know what? There are a couple of good things about hell. You believe it? Are there a couple of good things about hell too? I challenge you, there is.
Yeah, there
Here we go. A few good things in hell. All right? Number one, good thing in hell. Here we go. Good thing in hell. People.
People.
Really? Hey, are there not good people in hell? Amen. Right? Hey, there are some good people in hell. They did a lot of good, man. They gave to the poor. They did this and did that thing, man. They thought they were going to earn their way to heaven. Right? Oh, those good people, they're in hell. This rich man, it said that he helped provide, right? He helped provide for some people. Man, the poor person, man, he begged for table scraps from him. Right? Man. Yeah, there are some good people in hell. The rich man in this story was moral and caring. Being in hell is not about being good. There are lots and lots of really bad people in heaven and lots of really wonderful people in hell. The only way to heaven is by faith in Jesus Christ alone. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Not by deeds, acts, tithe, or anything else, just by Jesus Christ alone. Good or bad, it is no value in getting either into heaven or hell. It's not even about what you believe, it's who you believe in. All right, we ready for the second good thing in hell?
Bring it on.
The second good thing in hell.
Vision.
Vision, right? Good vision in hell. Being in torment in Hades, the rich man, he looked up a long distance away and he saw Abraham, right? He didn't need his glasses, man. He could see all the way to heaven, right? And he could identify Abraham at that far off distance. He could identify the poor man at that far off distance. His vision was excellent, right? Maybe part of the torment is to be able to see into heaven and to know that you could have experienced it for yourself. In the end, we shall also all see heaven, but only some of us will get to experience it. The rich man's vision was excellent, that he could now see a long ways off what he couldn't see prior in his life. All right. You getting the hang of this now? Right? What's the next good thing in hell?
Prayers.
Prayers, right? Hey, there are some good prayers in hell. What's the rich man say? Father Abraham. Right? He's begging. He's praying in hell. Right? Is he not? He called out, have mercy on me. Send Lazarus, dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, because I am in agony in the flame. Verse 24. I can't imagine how earnestly, how heartfelt, how sincere those prayers are from hell. How constant those prayers are in hell. Going to be a lot of praying people, I think, in hell. All right. What's another good thing in hell?
Memory.
Right? What does he say in verse 25? Son, Abraham said, remember that during your life you received your good things, just as Lazarus received bad things. But now he is comforted here, while you are in agony. You know, Abraham says, remember, man, it's good memory, man. I can remember the great days I had on earth. What a hoot. What a great time that was. Right? Your memory is good. Once again, probably part of the torment, you know? Man, why did I live so high on the hog for that short time of my life instead of caring, and as Billy Graham said, preparing, right, for the eventuality of your death.
In hell, we will remember the good life we had on earth, how we really lived it up, how we didn't miss a single opportunity to have fun or enjoy ourselves, how hard that will be when we end up in hell. You'll remember snowmobile church, baseball church, lazy day at home church. You'll remember those lost opportunities to worship the Lord. Okay. The next good thing in hell. Theology. Theology, right? Hey. Philippians 2:10-11 tells us, so that the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, in heaven, on earth, and under the earth. Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Hey, certainly this rich man confessed that Jesus was Lord, right? He knew then. He knew that he was Lord then. And it says that every knee shall bow, right? In heaven, on earth, and under the earth. It just depends on when you want to come to that realization. You know? Do you want to do it here on earth? Or do you want to wait for that realization until you arrive in hell? Now the rich man confesses Jesus is Lord. Yes, now he has the full knowledge of the tree of good and evil. Right? He has it all figured out at this point. Just as Adam when he walked in the Garden of Eden. I think it'll be quite sobering and straighten out a lot of theology that moment that somebody enters into hell. Okay. Here's another one. Good things in hell.
Good things.
Priorities. Priorities, right? Good priorities in hell. In verse 27 and 28, he says, Father, he said, then I beg you to send him to my father's house because I have five brothers. Warn them so that they don't come to this place of torment. You know, there's two huge priorities for this rich man after finding out there is no escape for relief from him. Number one, send a witness. Send a witness. The rich man isn't interested anymore in just himself, but he now pleads for someone to witness to his brothers. Right? And here on earth, we can be that witness, can we not? Amen. What's his second? His second priority is, he says, warn them, right? Prepare their hearts so they don't suffer the same fate. In short, what he's saying is, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you.
Right?
Amen. Said the rich man. Oh, sorry. That was Jesus. The rich man and Jesus said the same thing, right? Hey, that's our priority, to witness to people. That's Matthew 28:19-20. And you know what? You are fortunate today because I have a bonus family feud. The final good thing in hell is there are good intentions in hell, right? Good intentions in hell. What? One can reject Christ through outright rebellion, but rejection of the Lord doesn't have to be active. One can deny and refuse Christ also through apathy, through indifference, procrastination, or even ignorance. Some people fully intend to follow the Lord, and one day they plan to do so. The problem is, like the rich man, we don't know when that last day is going to come.
Amen.
Right? when our last day is to stop the procrastination and get on with the important business. Ultimately, you end up carrying your good intention with you right to hell. So this man, he had his priorities set up, man. He had good intentions in hell. He was all about getting on with business, right? When the torment and the torture started, he was ready, right? So in conclusion, hell is not prepared for you. No one has gone before to prepare a place for you. Jesus has prepared a place for you in heaven.
Yeah.
Jesus has prepared a place for you in heaven. No, hell is a place that you prepare for yourself. Don't let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house has many rooms. If it was not, I would have told you. I am going away to prepare a place for you. If you go away and prepare a place for you, I will come again and I will take you to myself, so that where I am, you may be also. Amen. You know the way to where I am going. Lord, Thomas said, we don't know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus told him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you also know my Father. For now on, you don't know him and who has seen him. That is John 14, 1 through 7. Okay, so let us pray before we leave. Lord God, thank you for this time together, Lord. Thank you for allowing us to have a little fun with the family feud today, Lord. Lord, I pray that we have learned both the place that hell is and the sorrow, Lord, the torment, the isolation, Lord, the removal from your presence, Lord. Lord, let it encourage us, Lord, to reach out to others, Lord. Lord, there are very real alternatives here, Lord, between heaven and hell, Lord. Give us the strength to make that awkward conversation. Lord, we pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Okay, and I have one final worship song, if you would all stand.
Hey folks, this is Pastor Dan, and I'd like to apologize for the quality of the video. You know, we had to sort of put this together at the last minute, and so I hope in future weeks we can do a little bit better job on that. And I just want all you folks that are watching this to know that we're in prayer for you, for your situation. And, you know, if you need help, the church wants to be that help. And so reach out to me, let me know what's going on, and I'll try to coordinate a response. So have a blessed week, stay healthy, and give them heaven. Amen. Bye-bye.